This is a sine wave. Let me show you something cool. If we zoom way into the center here, right around the origin, doesn't it just look like a linear function? I mean, there's definitely an equation for a line out there that would trace over the sine curve, or at least this part of it. Let's zoom out a little more. This part looks like a parabola, doesn't it? And this looks like a cubic function, and this just looks like any random polynomial. So we're noticing a pattern here. Like I said earlier, can we try to write an equation for a function that traces over the sine wave? We sure can. Let's call this function f, the approximator function. Okay, so where's a good place to start? First, we have to pick a place where we can anchor our approximator function. Let's call this place c, and let's pick the point x equals 0. Well, if we set f of 0 of our approximator function to be equal to sine of 0, that doesn't really help us. Our approximator function could look like anything as long as it goes through the point 0, 0, and that doesn't trace over the sine curve anywhere except for at that point. Okay, so let's set the first derivative of our approximator function equal to the first derivative of sine at our anchor point. Then our approximator function will increase at the same rate as sine, right? Yeah, not quite. See, now our approximator function is basically just tangent to the sine curve. It traces over the sine curve pretty well when we're near our anchor point at x equals 0, but as we get farther away, the rate of change of the sine curve starts to change. The rate of change of our approximator function was constant, so it can't keep up, and the sine curve starts to peel away. But wait, we know how the rate of change of sine is changing, right? That's just the second derivative of sine. So if we set the second derivative of our approximator function equal to the second derivative of sine 2, then our rates of change will be changing the same way. But the second derivative is changing, and that's dictated by the third derivative, and the third derivative is changing, and that's dictated by the fourth derivative. Basically, this pattern continues. The more derivatives of our approximator function we set equal to derivatives of the sine curve, the more we'll trace over the sine curve. So we understand what's conceptually going on, but where does the math come in? In other words, how can we find an equation for this function which traces over the sine curve? Let's take a look. So let's say that we want to show that the third derivative and up of our approximator function are equal to those of sine. We know that the third derivative of sine of x is just going to be negative cosine of x. Since we are anchored at x equals 0, we know that the third derivative of sine at x equals 0 is just going to be negative cosine of 0, or negative 1. So f triple prime of x is negative 1. Now let's step up the ladder. We can integrate f triple prime of x to get f double prime of x, which is going to be negative x plus c. But we also know that f double prime of 0 has to be equal to 0. How do we know this? Well, we said that the second derivative of our approximator function evaluated at our anchor point x equals 0 has to be equal to the second derivative of sine of x at x equals 0. The second derivative of sine is negative sine of x, and negative sine of 0 is equal to 0. So we can plug that into our equation for f double prime of x and solve for c. We get c is equal to 0, so therefore f double prime of x is just equal to negative x. Now let's integrate this function to get f prime of x. That gives us negative x squared over 2 plus c. Again, we can solve for c by setting f prime of 0 equal to the derivative of sine of x at 0. That's just 1. Plugging in 0 for x and 1 for f prime of 0, we can solve for c and get c equals 1. So our f prime of x equation is negative x squared over 2 plus 1. Let's take the integral of that. F of x is then going to be negative x cubed over 6 plus x plus c. Plug in 0 for x and sine of 0 for f of 0, and we get c equals 0. So our final equation for f of x is negative x cubed over 6 plus x. Let's plot this on top of sine. Wow, it traces over it. Of course, as we get further away from our anchor point, x equals 0, our approximator gets less accurate. But we can solve this by setting more than just the third derivatives equal to each other. Also, we picked our anchor point to be x equals 0, but really we can pick it to be any value we want. This just means our approximator function will be centered around our new anchor point and will get less and less accurate as you move away from it. That's why we normally indicate the anchor point in our equations with a little c, because it indicates the center of our approximator function. Also, this doesn't just work for approximating sine of x, it works for all functions, so long as you can take their derivatives without getting too much of a headache.
Let's go back to our equation for the sine approximator. We said that it was negative x cubed over 6 plus x. That's because we use the third derivative when setting up our approximator function. If we set the fourth derivatives equal and did the stair-stepping, then we would get x to the fifth over 120 minus x to the third over 6 plus x. If we started with the fifth derivative, we would have negative x to the seventh power over 5040 plus x to the fifth power over 120 minus x to the third power over 6 plus x. It turns out there's a pattern here. Let's rewrite these denominators. Turns out that they're just factorials of the exponents. The exponents are odd and the signs of the terms alternate. There's a way of writing this using series notation. Here it is. The big N is essentially just the number of derivatives that you're setting equal. When big N goes to infinity, we're setting all the derivatives of our approximator equal to derivatives of sine of x, and the approximator will match sine perfectly. The negative 1 to the power of N term basically makes the signs alternate, and 2N plus 1 cycles through the odd numbers. This kind of series, which describes functions that approximate other functions, is known as a Taylor series. We centered our approximator at c equals 0, which is why you don't see any other numbers, but if we wanted to center it at a different point, we would just shift it over to c, which is why we've got x minus c in parentheses over there. Here are some Taylor series for cosine of x, e of x, and 1 over 1 minus x. And here's the generic Taylor series formula, where you can plug in any function f and any center c. Taylor series are really useful for approximating the values of these functions. If someone gave you sine of 0.2 and asked you for the answer, it would be pretty hard to figure out. But if you plugged in 0.2 into the function negative x cubed over 6 plus x that we got earlier, that's a lot easier to calculate, and it should give you a similar answer so long as you're not too far away from your center. You can even modify Taylor series to approximate slightly different functions. For example, the Taylor series of sine of x over x is just the Taylor series for sine of x with each term divided by x. There are a couple more rules we need to follow when doing these transformations, but I'm not going to get into them for now. Anyway, that was a little exploration of Taylor series. Not bad at all.